Coach, curiosity, I was watching some report on sports, and especially at the professional levels, how now teams have psychiatrists and psychologists and want to make sure that the players are getting enough sleep and what they're eating when you're a professional. How much control do you have that over your players, and how much should you have?
Wow. You know, you wish you could control all of that, but you can't. You know, probably some schools where there are more resources and people and stuff, you probably get to manage it more than you think. But you'd be surprised. I mean, one of my former players that's Eldred Buckley's been hanging out here with us, and Eldred played for us at Chattanooga when I was coach there, and he played 4 years in the NFL, and he's here visiting with us, and he just recently got cut from Philadelphia Eagles. And so, you know, every day we're always asking Eldred, you know, something about whether it be Michael Vick or Donovan McNabb or Andy Reid and stuff. And I asked him a question the other day about pregame, you know, what he ate. And I thought he was going to give me some huge nutrition tip or whatever. He goes, hamburger, french fries. And this is with the Philadelphia Eagles.
Yeah.
You know, so some of that stuff can be blown out of, you know, overrated and blown out of proportion. But, you know, the biggest thing, these are college students, and they're not going to always eat the best. Luckily, their bodies, most of them, can tolerate it right now. And, I think the main thing is the rest. Being able to let their bodies to recuperate from the practice before, you know, but if they're staying up to, you know, 1 and 2 o'clock every night, and they're up in the mornings making it to 8 o'clock class, and then you know, meetings, class all day, and then meetings at 2:30, and then practice until 6:30, and study hall at night, and then it starts all over again. You got to get some rest.
Yeah, and mental fatigue, I guess, is just as bad as physical fatigue.
Well, it is. I kind of don't, you know, I don't buy that excuse from them, because they all would want to use that. But, no, it gets you, especially your younger players. The older players kind of get themselves into routine, and they know what to expect. It's your freshman, your redshirt freshman, that this is the first time they've played, and then school's thrown on top of them, and they don't really know how to pace themselves. And, you know, so they end up blowing something off, whether it be the sleep, you know, the eating correctly, or the, studying a little extra long for that test because they're so tired from practice. The younger kids study with that, obviously, a lot more than the older guys do.
Do you ever have, I know kids miss class. I mean, it happens. Anybody ever miss practice?
No, you don't miss practice.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
No, I mean, and there's issues that come up based on, you know, there's class things that come up, and they're excused for that. And as long as, you know, I know where they're going, you know, we just have to work around that. Some of our players have night classes, and it can be frustrating on Tuesdays and Wednesdays because they got to leave by 5:30. You still got another 45 minutes left to practice.
Yeah.
And the guys got to go. We try to limit that to our seniors or guys that have got to have certain classes, but sometimes it bleeds down into, you know, the sophomore and juniors based on if they're engineering students or, you know, their major. So, you know, but once again, it's college football, and they're here to be student athletes. And, you know, it's like I tell them all the time, the dog barks and the caravan moves on. So if I'm not here, if I'm not on sideline on Saturday night, the ball will still get kicked off at 6:30. And so we got to have somebody else step up and get ready to go.
How much do you help them in scheduling? I mean, do they have their own books, or do you have a schedule that you give them, or itinerary, or
based on practice, or based on
all
like,
of it?
Well, it's that's something that I'm real proud of our staff, and that's something that I take a lot of pride in. And it's not a perfect system, but you know, when we recruit these players, we tell them, and it's something that we live by. There's a Skyhawk way of doing things, and there's a lot of good coaches out there, especially in this conference and other schools we recruit against. But the one thing I take pride in is that myself as a head coach and our staff, you know, we're responsible for those players athletically, and that's easy. We're responsible for them academically, socially, and then as a head coach, I feel like I'm responsible for them to provide for them spiritually. And, you know, so there's things that go into that every day in meetings. You know, we had a, you know, hour-long academic meeting this morning at 8 o'clock, and Stacey Evans came in there, and we went through all of our, you know, 25 freshmen, and, you know, from A to Z of what they're doing good, what they're doing bad. You know, and that takes an hour or something out of your day as you're trying to get ready to play for Tennessee Tech. But that's part of it. That's what we're here for. And if you ever get, you know, if your staff ever tries to separate themselves from that, you're wrong, because you know that's what we're here for. Now, the balance is when I lose coaches and to reteach these guys how the checks and balances are in place can be difficult at times because there's a transition period and some coaches that come here that have been in other places have never had to monitor, check classes, help do schedules, you know, being, you know, they're responsible in every aspect of their player's life.
Yes. That's where it gets tricky with football, I think, as opposed to other sports. You have so many players.
Well, you do.
Or students.
Well, you do.
Man, whatever. People who are associated with your team that are student athletes or involved with the team.
You know, you do. And so you're looking at 96, 97 guys, and you know, as well as, you know, managers and filmers and trainers. And, you know, the head coach is responsible for, you know, for every one of them in some form of capacity. And but, you know, like I said, I've been very blessed. We've got a good staff, and these guys, you know, take care of their business. And you know, and as a head coach, that's part of your job description, is to be a problem solver.
You know, and what impresses me about football coaches, and I think you're very good at this, you know, even teachers have 25 or 30 students in the class. Mm-hmm. Not only do you have to know your players, you need to know mom and dad and kind of what their background is a little bit. I mean, as a head coach, that's part of your job.
Well, it is, you know, and I can't ever see myself being a head coach that doesn't take calls from parents, because, I mean, if my son's playing for you and something that I can't get the communication from him, where else am I going to go?
Right.
And so, you know, because whether it be the chancellor or the AD, they're not in day-to-day operations, you know, or contact with that individual. So, you know, can it be time-consuming? Yes. Can it be a distraction? No, because, you know, that child is sent here to me, and I'm their, you know, their father. They're father away from home, and our staff is as a group, so it's our job to, you know, try to provide for him in every aspect of his life. And are we always successful? No. I mean, you know, we're not always successful, but, you know, you've got to want to mess it up and go home for us to let that happen to you.
Do you put responsibilities on the older players to look out for the younger players too?
Yeah, you know, of course you try to. You know, you try to, and we've got some, the Julius McNairs, the Darren Nalls, the Derek Carrs. I mean, those guys are really good at mentoring those young players and stuff, because they're great examples and role models, you know, to live by and stuff. But it's so difficult, as you know, because they've got such a tight schedule during the day as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're trying to get Derek Carr over to the building to study every, you know, second of tape that he can, and you know, he's still got his studies, and you know, got to get his rest and do his weights, and there's just not a lot of time in the day, you know, so it falls back squarely back on the coaches.
Let's talk about the conference games from this past weekend, and all the home teams won. Air Force beats Tennessee State 63-24. That one at Air Force.
Yeah, you don't want to go play that triple option, so I feel for TSU.
Jacksonville State, Eastern Illinois, 28-21. Jacksonville State wins at home.
I thought Jacksonville won by more, especially at home, but you know, they're running the ball a little bit better. Eastern Illinois, I hadn't really studied them on tape yet.
Austin Peay wins at the house over Eastern Kentucky, 23-17.
A big surprise, only because Eastern Kentucky is one of the favorites in the league this year. You know, no offense to Austin Peay, but, you know, I thought Eastern would be able to be okay there, but that just means we better get ready for Austin Peay when they come in here next week.
Definitely. And, you know, you have said that you feel the conference champion could easily have two losses. I think the field is kind of folding that way a little bit. And we're going to talk about Tech in a minute. The Tennessee Tech wins over Southeast Missouri in a game you've seen a bunch, 38-31.
A good college football game. I mean, Southeast Missouri just lost a couple players from last year, but they were still productive. You know, Tennessee Tech did just enough on defense. They got one stop that they needed in order to win the game, but offensively they're very, very explosive, and you know, they're very hard to stop this week.
Before we talk about Tech in the next segment, I'm really am watching this Jacksonville State at Murray State game coming up, especially with Murray State being tied with us in the standings and Jacksonville State 2-0. How do you see this game unfolding, and what are the keys to that one if you're a color commentator on the network here?
Well, you know, it's kind of you know, anytime you beat a team handedly and you get beat by another team, your views can be a little bit skewed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they really are. But I will say this. I think losing to Murray State, losing this week, will get them tremendously refocused and somewhat, you know, playing with, you know, great intensity, because they don't want to lose that, make that second loss. Jacksonville State hasn't lost, and they're going to be on the road. So,
right.
But I also think Murray had a lot of players get banged up against us. So I think it all is also going to depend on, you know, who's healthy and returns this week, because if a couple of those wideouts are dinged up, then that may slow them down a little bit.
Very diplomatic. Way to go. We'll take a break and come back.
So did I pick anybody
no,
or not?
No, you didn't. You skillfully avoided that. We'll come back and talk about Tennessee Tech. I'm picking UT Martin in that one. We'll